All right, we are now live on YouTube. So first of all, I just want to say thank you so much for all of our panelists who have joined us today. And thank you to everyone on YouTube. We'll be getting started in just a couple minutes. While we were waiting to get started, I just want to let everyone know in the YouTube chat that if you have any questions throughout the presentation and throughout the discussion, feel free to post those in the YouTube chat. We will be checking that and also trying to bring them up throughout the conversation if they fit into what we're talking about, or if we miss a certain topic you're interested in, please let us know. One more thing before we get started, I would like to just go ahead and talk about introduce our student group and who we are that is hosting this event. So Portland State Aerospace Society is a club with Portland State University. We build rockets, satellites, and we also have a student group called Women in Aerospace, which is hosted by myself, Kara, who's on this call, and another person named Katie. And the three of us are the main folks who are part of Women in Aerospace for our student group. And we are a chapter of WOWA, which is another big space organization for students who are interested in aerospace. So we are hosting this event as a way to reach out to our community and spread information about the different and variety of careers within the aerospace industry. So if you're interested in learning more about us, we will have resources after the event that will include our websites and the types of content that we do. This is also our YouTube channel for our organization. So if you'd like to see some different rocket launches and other events we've done, you can check those out on our channel. All right, it looks like we have everyone here and we're ready to start since it is about 4:45, which was the time of this event. So again, thank you everyone for joining us on YouTube and on Zoom. My name is Nick. I am a math and physics major at Portland State University, and I'm a part of Portland State Aerospace Society and Women in Aerospace. This panel is the Space Law, Business, International Relation, and Policy panel. If you have any questions, again, feel free to send those at any time through the YouTube chat.
Yeah, and I'm Kara Geiser. I'm a high school student at Oregon Episcopal School, also part of the Portland State Aerospace Society and Women in Aerospace. Today we are joined by Dr. Angie Buckley, Andrea Harrington, Dr. Sarah Langston, and William Pomerantz. To start off, Dr. Angie Buckley is the Assistant Principal Director of the Exploration, Science, and Technology Organization in the Human Exploration and Spaceflight Division, Civil Systems Group at the Aerospace Corporation, and holds a PhD in Electrical Engineering. In her 35-plus year career, she has been a leader in biosciences, STEM, astrophysics, and nuclear thermal propulsion development, as well as an instructor contributing to the Center for Space Policy and Strategy. Dr. Andrea Harrington is the chair of the Department of Space Power and director of Schriever Space Scholars. She previously served as an associate director of the LLM program in Air and Space Law at the University of Mississippi School of Law, and as associate chair for the Policy, Economics, and Law Department of the International Space University's Space Studies Program. Dr. Harrington is also a licensed attorney in Massachusetts.
Next, we have Dr. Sarah Langston, who is an assistant professor of spaceflight operations at Embry-Riddle Aeronautical University. She is an international aerospace lawyer, practical ethicist, and U.S. Army veteran with a technical aviation background. Dr. Langston serves as a UNUSA Space for Women mentor, is an active member of the International Institute of Space Law, the Royal Aeronautical Society, the New York and District of Columbia bars, and is pursuing a private pilot's license. And finally, we have William Pomerantz, who is the Vice President for Special Projects at Virgin Orbit, which is Sir Richard Branson's satellite launch company. He helped start Virgin Orbit while working at Virgin Galactic. He is a co-founder of the Brooke Owens Fellowship and the Patty Grace Smith Fellowship, which are focused on enabling women and Black students to pursue aerospace careers. He is trustee and the chair of the board of advisors of SEDS USA and was editor-in-chief of spacealumni.com. So thank you everyone for joining us. We're very excited to have you all here. Just to get started, we'd like to just go down the line of panelists, starting with Will, and ask you all to briefly touch on what sparked your interest in your career.
Sure. Well, hi, everyone. Thank you so much for having me. It's an honor to be alongside such distinguished panelists today. I really owe my space career to being a student in SEDS, the Students for the Exploration and Development of Space. So, you know, when I grew up as a little kid, I liked space as much as the next kid, but I never really thought of it as an industry that I could work in. Part of that, I'm sure, is because I started wearing these when I was 8 years old, and at least back then, wearing glasses was enough to disqualify you from the astronaut corps. So I think my brain sort of closed off that part of the dream, and I never really realized that there was anything else. I guess I knew there were mission controllers, and that's sort of as far as my kid brain could go. And then fast forward to my freshman year in undergraduate, the beginning of, you know, every school year, I hope it is the same even in the COVID era, when every club on campus is trying to recruit every first year student. I happened to be walking through the Science Center at my university, and I saw a sign on a door saying introductory meeting of the Space Club SEDS. And it was starting in 2 or 3 minutes in the room I was standing outside of. And I said, oh, I like space. I'll go check it out, see what it is. And I am very, very glad that I did, because I ended up really falling in love with that club. I liked the people in it. I liked the activities. And through that, I discovered that space was an industry and that had lots of jobs, not just for astronauts and mission controllers, as wonderful as those two jobs are, but for scientists and lawyers and journalists and everyone else, like a lot of the themes of this very, very panel. So I changed my major. I majored in Earth and Planetary Sciences and really got started down a path that I have always been very appreciative of. I've loved working in this industry. I'm passionate about really every part of it, and everyone who's doing it in earnest, I'm a huge fan of. And I love to get to talk to people about it. So I'm grateful again to be here today.
That's awesome. Thank you, Will. Dr. Sarah, would you like to go next?
Sure. Can you hear me? Oh, good. All right. All right. So I had a bit of a roundabout career trajectory. I always wanted to be a pilot. And so I actually enlisted in the Army when I was 17, and I got to work on attack helicopters. I worked on the weapon systems for attack helicopters for several years. And then when I got out, I thought I wanted to be an aerospace engineer because I had this technical background. However, I realized very fast that math was not my forte. And so I started looking for other alternatives, and I found, you know, law. So that was kind of my backup plan. So I went down that route and found aerospace law when I was in law school. And then I pursued that and got every degree after that, basically around the math that I could, but still in the aerospace domain. And I worked with space industry startups and so forth. So it's all worked out. There's more, I think STEM is very important for space, but even if you're not a STEM discipline, there are plenty of options and careers if this is something you're interested in.
I love that. Thank you so much, Sarah. Dr. Andrea, would you like to go next?
Sure, thank you. So just to start out, I'll clarify from my bio that Air Command and Staff College is where I teach, and that's where the Schreiber Space Scholars concentration is housed. The Schreiber Space Scholars is the space-focused education for the intermediate level military education for the Air Force, and the Space Scholars in particular are funded by the Space Force and have been driven by the Space Force. So we have students in our class who are Space Force students, which is really exciting. Now they've made the transition and they've got the blue name tape to be in the US Space Force. So I'm also a lawyer, and I had been told ever since I was a small child that I think like a lawyer, which I'm not sure was always a compliment, especially when I was a little kid. But I am definitely not a math and science person. And as a result, even though I was passionate about space as a young child, to kind of echo what Will said, I didn't think there was a place for me in space, because I thought, okay, it's really the STEM people and that's not how my brain works. So I guess I have to find something else to do. I followed all of the space news and certainly also the science fiction. I was a big Star Trek fan as a kid. Whenever anybody asks me, I always talk about Captain Picard being a role model, being a role model for me, you know, kind of all the way through, right? And now I do international space law. And so what better role model than Jean-Luc Picard? But I got through law school. I also had a little bit of a roundabout career trajectory. So I worked in compliance in the financial industry, and then I went to law school. And after law school, I was drafting insurance contracts. And I thought to myself, you know, this job is fine. I don't mind going to work. I don't mind what I'm doing, but I really want to find something that I'm passionate about so that at the end of my career, when it comes to retirement, I can look back and be proud of what I was doing and not just going to a job every day. And I have always been passionate about space. And that's when I started doing some research online. And I discovered that there are, in fact, LLM programs, which are master's degrees for lawyers to specialize in a particular field. And so I discovered in particular that McGill had both an LLM and an academic doctorate in air and space law. And I went up to McGill and I did both of those degrees. While I was there, I realized that what I really wanted to do within the field of space law was teach. And so after my time at McGill, I went to the University of Mississippi and I was teaching there. And now I'm at Air Command and Staff College. So I went from teaching law students now to teaching military officers.
That's amazing. Thank you so much for expanding on that and clarifying. That's some amazing experience. Dr. Andy, could you share next?
Sure. Thank you. I guess I've been interested in space ever since I found out there was this thing called space. I mean, I remember in the first grade, I could tell you all the planets. I spent a lot more time, you know, learning about space things than I did about, you know, the lessons I was supposed to be focusing on. But I've always loved math and science. And so it was kind of inevitable that I would end up in some kind of technical field. And I guess I just got lucky to end up in the space business. I was on a trajectory in college, well, through high school and college, to go into the medical profession. But when I got in university, I found out about this wonderful field called engineering, you know. And so I jumped right into that and ended up taking my first job in a place called Huntsville, Alabama. So if anybody knows anything about space, you know, that's pretty much what happens in Huntsville, Alabama. So, and I might be the only panelist that's old enough to remember the Apollo moon landing in 1969. I don't think most of you guys would have remembered that, but that was so inspirational. And it was so inspirational that I spent a lot of my time building model rockets, and I built a model of the Saturn V that, you know, actually worked and came apart, and thing was almost as tall as me, but, you know, I was just into it. So went to work in Huntsville. I wanted to be an astronaut also. And I applied and I applied and I applied. And then finally found out that having exercise-induced asthma, which I have, is an automatic disqualifier. So like Will, I discovered that there's so many other things that you can do in the space business. And one thing that everyone should remember is that it's not just the engineers and scientists. It takes the lawyers, it takes the medical doctors. A huge area in space right now is, you know, how do we take care of humans when they go off planet for any period of time, you know? So there's room, it's a big tent. So if you've got any interest in space, you know, even if you're going into business or even philosophy or psychology, there's room in the space business. And it's the most wonderful profession that I can think of. Of course, I'm a little bit biased on that point. And then when I went to International Space University, that was pretty much it. So I think we've all got that in common, the ISU tie. So yeah, that's it for me. Over.
Yeah, that's amazing. One of the really the biggest reason why we're doing these panels anyways is to expose high school students who are still trying to find what they want to do in their life, and expose them to all the different types of jobs that are out there in the aerospace industry, because we've noticed it was very, you know, central around engineering, and but it really takes so many different jobs. It takes business, it takes law, it takes everything, and it's all really important. I'll also go down the line for this question. A lot of people in the RSVP were wondering, what really is space law? Like, how would you define space law? Starting with Will.
Well, I'll keep my comments briefly because my colleagues are much smarter and more knowledgeable on this than I am. But I'll say from an industry perspective, you know, space law is what ensures that we can do the things we want to do without getting anyone in anyone else's way or harming anyone else. So I work right now at a launch company. We attach a 70-foot long rocket under the wing of a Boeing 747, as you can kind of see in the picture behind me there. And that's a complex operation. We want to do that without bothering our neighbors or, heaven forbid, doing anything worse. But we also want to actually do it. We don't want to have to just spend all year filling out paperwork because we would like to do it in the future. We want to be able to get it done. And so to me, from an industry perspective, space law is about finding and space policy and space regulation, which I will group all together, although I'm sure my colleagues will maybe draw the lines between them more distinctly and more helpfully, is all about how do you give people the ground rules so we all know what we can do, what we can't do, and then we all have some common vocabulary and some common structure in place so that we can go and get it done in a reliable, thorough way, but in a way that we can predict in advance.
Yeah, so many great points. Sarah.
So it's a little bit of a tricky question. It's space law in and of itself is basically the rules of the road for space, like Will said, or for the use of space. And we have international treaty systems that address the use of space for states, for countries. And then we also have national laws, regulations, and policies. And it's really an amalgamation or a combination of all of the laws, the policies, and the regulations together. But these are also distinct disciplines. They're also distinct career paths. So I did want to raise that too. You don't have to be a lawyer to work in space policy or space regulation. What I teach at Embry-Riddle is space law, international space law, and I also teach US space law, and that includes the regulations and the licensing for anybody who is interested in engaging in space activities. And then we also touch on the space policies, which again is not directly regulatory necessarily in nature, but refers more to the federal branches and activities with the government. So there's lots of different aspects of this, and depending on who you are and what you're interested in doing in space, there could be a pertinent regulatory aspect, or if you are a US company wanting to work with a international company, then that could trigger some international law considerations too, which are very interesting. And I think this is what space lawyers find fascinating about this topic, is there's so many different aspects and parameters and possible partners and combinations to look at here. So every situation, every case is very unique. And so nothing is never exactly the same. It always raises some interesting issues and challenges, and you know, there's always solutions, right? So it's about working towards finding a solution.
Yeah, so many really amazing points. Dr. Andrea.
Thanks. So having taught space law at a law school, and to kind of echo some of the comments that Sarah had, there are a lot of different aspects to this field. And so if you do want to be a lawyer and you think that space law is something you might want to get involved in, I always advise students to also have another specialty in addition to just space law, because the companies and the organizations that are looking for space lawyers are looking for folks who can contribute to the overall mission. So for example, labor law, or administrative law, or in my case, insurance law, contract law, an area like this to complement your space law knowledge is really gonna enhance your higher ability in the field and your ability to succeed in the field. To give you a little bit more of information, if you're interested in digging into space law yourself, if you're interested in the international space law piece of it, the UNOOSA website has all the treaties and the UN resolutions from the UN Committee on the Peaceful Uses of Outer Space. They also have a database of national space laws, so you can read the domestic space laws of a bunch of different countries, all linked from that one convenient source. I will say that international space law is not limited to the treaties that have come from the UN Committee on the Peaceful Uses of Outer Space. So space law is a part of international law in general. So if you're interested in international law, that's a large point of connection. So you get international environmental law and all sorts of other aspects that come through for space. And other treaties that come from other UN committees, other multilateral and bilateral treaties beyond just the ones from UNCOPUS. So the International Telecommunications Union and the documents, the treaties from the ITU, the International Telecommunications Union, are incredibly important to activities in space, dealing with radio frequencies and orbital slot allocations. So there's a lot more, even just to international space law, than just the Outer Space Treaty and the follow-on treaties from that. And then when you start adding domestic law, domestic regulations, and all the policy questions to that, there's actually a very large body of law and then all the policies to look at there.
For sure. Angie.
So I'm not sure how much I can add to this discussion because, you know, the two experts have spoken and Will has given a very good explanation as well. I'm going to give it to you from an engineer standpoint. I think it's hugely important that if you are in the technical fields, regardless of what field you're working in and you're one of the technical people, you really need to try to broaden your horizons and understand the laws and the policies that are associated with your field. And that's why I've spent probably more time than a lot of, you know, my engineering colleagues digging into international space law, space policy, because basically that tells me what I can do. It kind of sets the parameters so that we stay within the policy of the United States for U.S. activities. But it also helps you to understand where all this comes from and why it's important. And I guess the major thing that you know space law is meant for is for, you know, making sure that we use outer space for the betterment of humanity, you know, and trying to come up with norms of behavior and regulations so that we can expand and use space in a way that's going to benefit everyone here. But I think it's really important to understand all of that and understand that like was said before, it's not just the United Nations treaties, but it trickles all the way down to, you know, the nation state level. So I think that's about all I can add to this expert discussion. So thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Angie. Another question that we have is kind of stepping off of that and from a variety of questions that we received in our RSVP from different students and also in the chat, some folks are touching on it. But what are your thoughts on how law and policy may change as and way in the future we start to settle potentially on other planets, like say Mars? Like if we're going to Mars, how do you see law and the aerospace industry kind of shifting as we make like those changes to places that aren't Earth? And we can start with anyone who's interested. Maybe Dr. Sarah?
Sure. So this is a question I actually get a lot. So it's very intriguing. One thing we have to understand is that when the Outer Space Treaty was adopted, and that was in 1967, so it is, you know, a few decades old, but the original discussions did look at this treaty system applying to our solar system. So going to Mars, we can actually extend the current space law regime that we have, and also the other applicable international laws that would apply. And it's going to be highly unlikely that it's going to be one person, one party going to Mars on their own. This is most likely going to be a multinational, multi-conglomerate mission. So it's inherently going to have an international or multinational aspect to that, which already ties in international law. And I do think that's an important concept to keep in mind, because going to Mars inherently requires international cooperation and collaboration. And so that kind of ties into it. But once humans have been on Mars, and this is in the distant future, not right away, but in the distant future, once they are able to establish themselves as a permanent settlement and as a permanent society, we do actually, under international law, have a framework and a principle that allows for self-determination and allows for a settlement to eventually become a nation, if that's what they're interested in. But we actually have that established under international law. So it's interesting when you hear or see things on the news and you're like, well, that's not, you can't just go to Mars and establish your own country or your own planet. That's not how it works. International law still applies. And we actually, and this is the good thing, I mean, this is the benefit, that we already have these frameworks for these activities. So we don't need to create them from scratch. We can build upon them. But obviously we will be building on them, not in isolation, but in conglomeration with others.
Thank you, Sarah. Dr. Andrea, go ahead.
I think Angie was raising her hand. If you want to go first, Angie, I can wait.
Oh, sorry.
That's okay.
No, please go ahead.
What I was going to say is, I think these questions are really interesting, and Sarah is absolutely right. We have these mechanisms in international law, but they might pose an interesting challenge to the Outer Space Treaty, in terms of when you start getting folks that are actually born on another celestial body and raised on another celestial body and maybe couldn't even sustain themselves in Earth's gravity. But we're a long way from getting to those questions, because we're still actually not sure if it's possible to conceive or gestate a human in space in lower gravity than where we are now. And so I think these are really interesting questions to look at in the longer term. And I do think that the existing international law will be able to accommodate these changes as they continue to grow and evolve. And I do use science fiction as examples, and we talk about in my classes, okay, how would you deal with this problem under existing international space law if this happened? And so Leviathan Wakes, which is the first book in the Expanse series, if you've seen the Expanse, is one that I've used quite frequently to pull examples. And in that book, actually, you have a Mars that has declared independence from Earth and has become a second great power in a solar system, international, or rather interplanetary regime, right? So these are interesting questions that we're looking at and discussing and debating. And the one that's likely to be the closest one on the horizon from an innovative, almost science fiction-y standpoint is space resource extraction and utilization. And if you're wondering what that means, space mining is the less formal way to say that and the less correct way to say that, but can tie you in and give you the idea of what's going on. And that's being discussed and debated at the international level. Agreements for cooperation on space resource utilization are already being put into place in the Artemis Accords, bilateral agreements that the United States has begun establishing with other states, other countries. And so this stuff is happening now, and we have the law in place to accommodate it, and we'll need folks who know it and understand it to be able to continue to develop that regime moving forward. So I think the next generation of space lawyers and also space policy experts are going to play a very important role as these continuing events and activities develop, and as humans move out into the solar system and start making more use of our solar system.
Thank you, Dr. Andrea. Dr. Angie?
Yeah, Andrea made the point that I was going to get to. I know it's, we're talking about governance issues when humans eventually move off planet. We're thinking about Mars, and that's pretty far in the future. And I just want to reinforce the point that was made that we're going to see this happening sooner than later, because I know there are private companies and governments that see the moon as a potential place to to harvest resources that could be used on Earth. So they're thinking about that. I know there's studies ongoing about how do you do that? How do you actually set up a, you know, mining operation on the moon and harvest those resources in such a way as you can efficiently and affordably get them back to the Earth. But this is something we're going to have to deal with as soon as companies figure out how to wrap a business case around lunar resources for use either in space or on Earth. And by wrap a business case around it, I mean when they sort out how to make it profitable, when commercial industry figures that out, then that's going to cause policymakers to step back and think about what policies are we going to implement as we potentially exploit what resources are on the moon and other celestial bodies. Did I get that right, Andrea and Sarah? That's all. Just something to think about.
Yeah, for sure. Thank you. As said, we got a lot of questions from various RSVPs about space law in general, but more about the process of going into space law. Obviously, it's a lot of collaboration and it's a lot of talking to people. And going down the lines, starting with Dr. Sarah, what do you think is the best skill when it comes to managing people or a group of people?
The best skill, good communication skills, I would say, especially when you're looking at the aerospace community. We are inherently a global community. I myself am a third culture kid. I was born in the Middle East. My father was American, my mother Italian. I grew up in Europe, didn't come to the States till I was 17. So I think for me, that ability to communicate and get along with people from all different cultures, all different languages, and being able to find that common ground and the desire to find solutions to whatever it is that you're working on, I think that's a very important skill.
Yeah, for sure, definitely. Will?
So I'm not a space lawyer, so I'll talk from our perspective and just give a shout out to something I think all of us will have in common, which is the need for interdisciplinary education and skills. You know, my first degree is in science. I now work more on the business and management and communication side. But every job I know of in the aerospace industry involves pretty much every day talking to people who work in another discipline than you do. And what I found happens all too often is students, even the smartest and most curious students who go to the best universities in the world, all too often are so focused on their own discipline that they learn nothing about the disciplines, even the ones immediately adjacent to theirs. I remember, graduating from, a pretty good school with a degree in planetary science. And I'd never even taken a single engineering class or worked with an engineer on anything, not once, not a single day on it. And when you go into industry, that is all you do every day. You're talking to the engineers who are building the instruments and figuring out how to get you better data and how to fix something that's broken and how to prioritize what you can do in the next mission. And then you go and you talk to the policy people who are setting the goals for, okay, what are we gonna do 5 years from now and 10 years from now? And the business people who are helping pull all that together. And you can quickly not only be lost, but you can quickly find that you're actively pulling in opposite directions without knowing it at all, just because the goals of those disciplines sometimes are a little bit orthogonal to each other. You're just kind of pulling in a different direction. And if you're not careful about that, that can really hamper progress very, very quickly and very permanently. So I'm excited for anyone who's watching this who is curious about the fields like space law or business or the others. And I would encourage you, even if you don't think that's going to be your forever job, watch more things like this and, read the writings of my great panelists, fellow panelists here and others, because just kind of soaking in those words and those ideas at a young age is going to really pay dividends down the road.
Yes, that's some amazing advice. Dr. Andrea.
Thanks. I think it's really important that you find a balance between advocacy, but also keeping an open mind to other people's ideas and arguments. So you want to be able to strongly advocate the position that you have and articulate the reasons that you hold that position, but you need to keep your mind open that your position can and sometimes should change depending on other influences as circumstances change, as new ideas are introduced, new theories, new analyses, new space activities, new technologies, new business models, that, space is a rapidly changing environment. And so being able to do both of those things, be an advocate, but also keep an open mind and recognize when you need to revise your position and doing so honestly, I think is something really important to be thinking about if you're considering a career in this field.
Yes, thank you. Dr. Angie.
Just to emphasize some of the points that have already been made, I think communications is hugely important, but communications is a two-way story. You need to learn to listen. I mean, that's been the biggest lesson for me is learning to listen to my colleagues, learning to listen to experts that aren't in my field. It helps me gain a broader perspective and it helps me make, as a leader, helps me make better decisions. So listening is hugely important. Interdisciplinary education is really important as well. And Will, I appreciate you saying that because I think a lot of people, like you said, they get so focused on their little niche area that they don't even realize some of this other stuff is going on around them. So broaden your horizons. And if you don't already speak a second language, learn one, okay? The world is getting very small, all right? Granted, most business is done in English, but I think it would build your character enormously and say a lot about you as a human being to just try to learn a second language. I've tried to learn three. Okay. I'm doing pretty good with French, but I have to, because my husband's French. Okay. I'll give it that, but I think it's really important that you, that you do that, listen to people, and like Andrea said, be willing to change because, you're not right all the time. And also keep in mind, even if you don't go into the field of or into the space enterprise, business all in every regime is changing. It's not just the space business that's changing. It's all becoming very international. So these skills will serve you across a broad range of businesses and industries. But I think it's real important that you think about these points. Over.
Thank you so much, Dr. Angie. Stemming right off of exactly what you just said about how the industry is going to continue to evolve, how would all of you recommend current high school students be preparing for those shifts and advancement of the aerospace industry, especially business-wise and law and policy-wise over the next 10 or more years? Let's start with Will.
Well, if you're watching this, you're off to a great start. You live in a great time where you've got YouTube and you've got Zoom and you've got Twitter and all these other things. And, as much as Twitter can sometimes seem like a dumpster fire, it can also be a really wonderful platform for you to connect with other people. And space Twitter is a thing. There are lots of space community leaders, lots of space community professionals, lots of really thoughtful people in the industry who use Twitter well and use it both to broadcast messages and to engage with people, including young people. One thing I've always really enjoyed about working in the space industry, one thing that makes me confident that I made the right choice, is pretty much everyone in this industry is in it because they love it. And when you're in an industry because you love it rather than because it's the convenient thing that will pay you enough, you often want to talk about it and you want to talk to young people about it and you want them to follow in your footsteps and you want them to surpass you, frankly. If a young person like you surpasses me, I will be the happiest person about it. And I don't know that's true in every other industry, but that really is true of almost everyone I know in the space industry. So not being shy, reaching out to people, whether it's young people, whether it's joining things like SEDS or WOA or other organizations like that, which I think are all fantastic. It can get you not only industry exposure, but leadership experience at a young age. whether it's using online services. I'll put in a plug for at the Brooke Owens Fellowship, we have something called Ask a Brookie, a great way for any student or any person of any age to talk to an incredible young woman or gender minority in aerospace and get their perspective. And there's lots of other ways. I mean, you can get downlinks with the astronauts on international space stations if you get enough kids together, and that's pretty darn awesome. So be curious, ask all the time, figure out who the space journalists are and follow them on Twitter or at the places they write, figure out who the sort of thought leaders are and follow them on social media, and you can learn a hell of a lot really, really quickly that way.
Thank you, Will. Dr. Sarah?
So I think Will touched on everything I was going to say. So I think it's really important to expose yourself to as much information and also evaluate the information that you're getting and then tailor it to your interests. So if you are interested in going to law school and becoming a space lawyer, then start following a couple space lawyers. And in a way, you create your own mentorship by subscribing to the news feeds, to the blog posts, and to the Twitter's messages that different individuals are putting out. And you don't even have to know a person, or it also can segue into a networking opportunity as well. So create your own opportunities through staying tuned into the industry and staying tuned into current events, because especially if you're interested in business law policy, what's going on right now is going to be super important to your interests and also to your studies in that field. So just stay open. And also there's a lot of really good free webinars and talks, and there's so many different platforms. Air and Space Museum has lots of talks, and whether you're in person or able to virtually listen to the talks, whenever you're free, I think that's really important. It's about continuation with learning. And I think for all of us here on this panel, I think it's pretty obvious that none of us have stopped learning. We're still learning, right? Every single day. So welcome to lifelong learning if you're interested in aerospace.
Thank you, Dr. Sarah. Dr. Andrea,
go ahead. So a couple of specific recommendations. If you're interested in the space industry, join the Space Generation Advisory Council, SGAC, Space Generation Advisory Council. It's free to join, and there are lots of great resources for young folks. It's specifically geared towards people who are under 35, so it's not too early for you to sign up when you're in high school. You'll probably get the most out of it when you're in college and shortly thereafter when you get access to all the internship opportunities and the prize opportunities that they're providing. But I think even at the high school level, there's value to joining now and getting integrated in that community now. As Will pointed out, everybody in the space industry pretty much is really passionate about space, which means that there are lots of opportunities to get great mentors. People want other folks getting involved and getting excited about space, and they like to talk to other people who are excited about space, especially young people. So don't hesitate to reach out and try to make those connections and use the tools that are out there to make those connections, because we love space and we want more people to be involved and to grow the expertise in the industry from the youngest generation up. The next thing that I'll say is utilize some news sources like Space News. There are news feeds you can get sent to your email box daily if you want daily updates on the headlines that are going on in space, whether it's civil, commercial, or military. And those three aspects of space are all important, right? There's civil, commercial, and military. So you can think about what you're most interested in and where you might want to focus out of those three. But keep up to date on the developments in all three areas from Space News, because I think that's a great opportunity as well.
Thank you, Dr. Andrea. Dr. Angie, go ahead.
Yeah, I think most of the points I was going to make have, again, already been made. That's the bad part of going last. But the good part about going last is that you can emphasize some of the points that you think are the most important. And I think if the bottom line message is get involved in some kind of networking organization like SEDS or SGAC, pay attention to what's going on in the industry. It's not that hard. You can monitor this on Twitter. You can monitor it on, on the internet. You can get things sent directly to your phone. So keep up with it that way, and just pay attention. So I think that's about all the things I can add to the wonderful comments that have already been put out there. Thank you.
Yeah, amazing. This question is for Will specifically, and you touched on the Brooke Owens Fellowship and also various other opportunities. And I know as a high school student, it's sometimes difficult to know what to prepare for or how to prepare for an opportunity like the Brooke Owens Fellowship. Could you describe, talk a little bit more about them and how you think a student should best prepare for them?
Yeah, I would love to. You're going to have to stop me at some point because I could talk about this for hours, but I'll try and keep it brief. I have always been really passionate about getting more people involved in the industry because I do think it's a great industry. And I think we need more people. And I think we need a hell of a lot more diversity of people than the industry has ever had. I've also noticed, you know, being involved, really involved in a number of these student organizations over the years, there's always been this problem that existed when I was coming out of school, and it still exists today, of basically every job posting on every company's website requires 5 years experience, which sort of begs the question of where the heck do you get the first 5 years? Trying to find both ways to convince companies that that's not the right thing to do and agencies and everyone else, but also helping students find ways to overcome that has been a real passion of mine. So very proud to be a co-founder of the two fellowships. You mentioned the Brooke Owens Fellowship and the Patty Gray Smith Fellowship. Those are both about creating real on-roads into the industry for incredible young people whose demographics are not well enough represented in the industry. So Brooke Owens Fellowship is specifically for women and gender minorities. The Patty Gray Smith Fellowship is specifically for Black and African American students. The industry numbers for both of those demographic groups are deplorable and not getting better, certainly not at anything higher than glacial speed. And if people don't, those are not problems that we're just going to age out of, which I think is the mistake that a lot of well-meaning people make. They just sort of say, if we wait 50 years, that's an old problem that we just have to wait for it to correct. And I don't think that's true without people taking a step. And I also, you know, believe and have seen the data over and over and over again. It's not for lack of interest from those groups. It's for lack of us being inviting and welcoming. So we created these programs to try and find really killer jobs for people in those groups and to pair them with incredible mentors and to give them a support network of like-minded peers. And the programs have both become really hard to get into because there was so much pent-up demand that was not finding the recognition that it had always deserved in the industry. So they are hard to get into, but possible. You know, my main things to say to any young person, whether it's looking at those fellowships in particular or any other internship or school admission, graduate school, anything else, is first of all, take more shots than you think you should. There's an old expression, you miss 100% of the shots on goal you don't take. And I find all too often students don't apply for things because they don't think they'll get it. And that's the surest way to not get it. So there's a lot of great, you know, books and expressions and helpful guides out there. But at some point, putting yourself out there for a position, even if you think you'll probably get rejected, you might be surprised. And even if you aren't, you might learn something interesting along the way. You might get a useful piece of feedback or make a connection or whatever else. It's the number one thing I see students do wrong or not do as well as they could, at least on their road. And then the other big thing is maybe a little more specialized to some roles in some parts of the industry. But I would encourage all students to remember that the stuff you do outside of the classroom is often just as important as the stuff you do inside the classroom. In some parts of the industry, it's much more important. There are lots of companies out there, I think mine is one of them, that don't really care what a student's GPA is. We care much, much more about what you've done, you know, in clubs. We care much, much more about what you've done in other jobs if you've had them, particularly if you want an engineering job. I don't necessarily care how quickly you turned in your final exam in an engineering class. I want to know what you built. And I want to know what you've broken. And I want to know what you did when you broke it and how you recovered from that. That's the really interesting things that tells me how quickly a young person learns, how resilient they are, how creative they are, how broadly they're thinking. And the fact that you might have made a mistake or two along the way is a good thing rather than a bad thing, because we all do it. And if you've already done it, then that means you're not going to necessarily make the same mistakes again. So those would be my tips. I'd love to hear what the others have in mind.
That's awesome. Thank you so much, Will, for sharing about that. I would like to jump into a few more specific questions to different panelists about different organizations like that. First, I'd like to start with Dr. Sarah and anyone else who's familiar with UNOOSA Space for Women. If you could just describe your experience with them and also how students can get involved with that and the benefits of that, that'd be great.
Yes, yeah, so the Space for Women Initiative was started in 2017. That was the first meeting of bringing together different women experts from all over the world. And we met in New York. And the goal there was working with UNUSA, which is the UN Office for Outer Space Affairs, and also UN Women, and seeing how can we foster the role of women and diversity in space. I mean, obviously we know that space needs all of us to contribute if we want to be successful in getting there. But like Will said, there's often a disparity in the demographics and those who are able to participate and have access to the opportunities. So the Space for Women Initiative is particularly for incorporating gender diversity into the space arena. And the Space for Women Mentor Network that I'm a part of is there's 36 of us around the world. And whoever has an interest in connecting with someone, especially folks, I mean, in the US, perhaps there's a little bit more access to experts, but in a lot of countries, they don't have access to experts. So we actually field a lot of mentees from countries all over the world, and we just communicate with them. And sometimes it's a monthly call, just networking. Sometimes it's every 2 months or whatever the mentee needs. We're just in communication with them. So that's a wonderful program that they've started. And we do events, and there's lots of different organizations that are involved. And so there's a lot of webinars that go on under these auspices and stuff. So it's a really good way to connect with others and also to realize how global the aerospace sector is, the industry is, but also the concern for diversity is also a global issue. When we're looking at women in space or gender diversity, it's not just about diversity in US aerospace, it's about aerospace globally.
Yeah, thank you. This next question is more specific for Dr. Angie. It's kind of a specific question, but what do you think is the most exciting advancement in your eyes that, whether it's through business or whether it isn't from an engineering point of view, in nuclear thermal propulsion?
Somebody new. I've been working with nuclear thermal propulsion, about 2 years now. We've still got a lot of work to do, but the fact that we're talking about it again, and this is not the first time that it's been talked about, it was looked at seriously in the 60s, believe it or not, and in the 70s, and now it's making a comeback. But now we're a lot smarter, and now we understand that we don't need to use, bomb-type uranium to do it. We can use enriched uranium, but it doesn't have to be highly enriched uranium. So that in itself is a big breakthrough in learning how to make a reactor that can use that kind of fuel and put it on a rocket where you're going to have people on the other end of the rocket. I think that's pretty remarkable. We're still, we still got some years of work to do, but that's probably the most viable way to get people to Mars in a time frame or much quicker travel time than by conventional propulsion. So it's a really exciting field. We're also looking at nuclear electric propulsion. I think there's room for both. If you wanna get something somewhere fast, use nuclear thermal. If you've got a lot of time to get them there, use nuclear electric. Nuclear electric is very efficient, but it doesn't produce a lot of thrust, but you can still get there. So wonderful things happening. Over.
Thank you for sharing, Angie. That's great to hear about. And Dr. Andrea, we just had a question about, I know you were touching on military and Space Force. We had a few students who are interested in that aspect and curious about how they can get involved or like what they could do to prepare if they're interested in going that direction with the aerospace industry.
So if you're interested in U.S. Space Force, I think it's really super cool that we're at a point in time where I can be talking to high school students and say, hey, you could join the U.S. Space Force. Like, you could have a military career in the U.S. Space Force, right? So folks, the first graduates from basic training for Space Force just graduated earlier this week. And so, you know, there's an enlisted route to going into Space Force if you wanted to do military service to be able to earn your GI Bill and then get your college paid for after, you know, after you do a stint of military service like you would in any other branch. And if you do that in Space Force and you get some space chops, then you go study and get a degree that just builds your resume even further to get out into that field. And if there's a chance at the end, I'll let Dr. Sarah talk about if her experiences, if that's relevant for the folks on here that are interested, because she has much more personal experience with that than I do. But if you're interested in an officer track, the Air Force Academy is still graduating Space Force graduates. So there's the first class of officers that graduated from the Air Force Academy going straight into the Space Force graduated this year as well. So that's the officer track option. If you're interested in going officer track, there are a number of majors at the Academy that you can look into there. Of course, Space Force is very interested in the STEM fields. And so if you know you want to go that route, or you're thinking you might want to, okay, let me go through college. I'm not sure if I really necessarily want to do military service, but keeping the options as open as possible. And there's certainly a high level of interest in the STEM fields, although not exclusively the STEM fields, certainly for US Space Force. And Sarah, I don't know if I can let you piggyback on your personal experience with military service.
Yeah, I have to say Space Force is very new, and I was in the military a couple decades ago. So I would say look at the requirements for Space Force now. I don't know what jobs they're looking to fill as well. Normally there's certain mission specific job requirements that they have, and you normally test into that. So if that's something you're interested in, look at the appropriate testing, the ASVAB or whatever they're giving now to see. There are obviously the two avenues. I was enlisted, so I didn't go the officer route. I signed up when I was 17, and they were looking for aircraft armament and missile system specialists. And so that's what I worked on. I was trained on the Cobra helicopter, and I actually ended up working on the OH-58 Delta. So just because you train on one technology doesn't mean that's the only thing you'll be working on. But that's definitely one route. And I did that for the reasons, you know, I didn't have college money at that time. And obviously to be an officer, you have to have a college degree. But there are also ways to get, you know, the college degree sponsored by going through ROTC, the ROTC. We do offer that, those programs at Embry-Riddle, but many colleges have them as well. So that could be an option for you. It really depends on what your interests are and also where are you in life. Not everybody has the same access and opportunity. And I do want to make that very clear that there is always a way forward. So don't ever get discouraged. There's always a way forward, but it won't necessarily be the same for everybody. So you need to see what fits for you, what fits for your objectives, and what fits for your family. And then choose talk to as many people, talk to recruiters, talk to, if you are close to going to college, go to college and talk to the cadre in the different, the cadre is the military leadership for the branch that you're interested in, whether it's, if it's Space Force, if it's Air Force, if it's Army, and we have all the military branches at Embry-Riddle. So see what's available to you, but really just talk to folks and see what clicks with you, what resonates with you, what are you interested in? And it's those connections. But I do think it's really important to, as much as possible, try to connect with folks in person, because oftentimes what you read may not be the full picture, right? So there's lots of brochures, lots of things you can find online, but it's even better to connect with somebody. And that just means reaching out and making a phone call or sending an email. And most people are very amenable to responding and helping you.
Yeah, amazing. This will be our last question, but this is kind of going off of what Will said earlier about how a lot of students especially don't apply because they're afraid of applying. And my question would be for development, probably specifically for a resume, what are some big do's and don'ts that you have seen in the past that you would like to share with everyone watching, starting with Will?
Yeah. So have a friend review it and then have another friend review it, double check it, triple check it. Little things like typos occasionally will get you knocked out of the running for an entire job, which is, you know, it's a big price to pay for a small mistake. And your friends, a fresh set of eyes is always helpful to catch things like typos. The other more specific one I have is, goes back to something I mentioned earlier about your outside of the classroom activities. And this may not be universally applicable. I don't know if there's an equivalent in the law and policy fields, and look forward to learning from the others if there is. But if you are active in SEDS or WOA or other organizations like that, that is absolutely something that should be on your resume. And it shouldn't just be there for, at least for a lot of jobs, it shouldn't just be there as one bullet point in the very bottom in the other hobbies and interests section. If you had a leadership role, if you put together a whole panel and moderated it by yourself with your friends, if you're on the rocket team, don't say you're on the rocket team. Say, I was in charge of structures my freshman year, and I wrote the software my sophomore year, and you know, whatever else. Get a little bit specific. Sometimes students just leave that off entirely, and other times they're so proud of the team, they brag about the team, and they'll say, I was part of the Rocket Club that was the first university rocket club to do XYZ, which doesn't tell me anything about what you did or what you learned. So get specific about that, ideally in the resume if you have room. If not, be really prepared to proactively bring that stuff up in a job interview. And I referenced this earlier, but even if it didn't end well, that's okay when you're a student, you know, because I know that you'll never make that mistake of installing the parachutes upside down again or whatever it else. As long as you have a nice end to the story of, here's how I figured out what we did wrong, and here's how we address that the next time, and here's what we learned from it, and here's the unexpected discovery we had from it. If you can tell that part of the story, then those stories are really, really wonderful stories to have, not rehearsed necessarily, but to be have them front of mind and be able to bring them up in a job interview, because they'll really impress people.
Yeah, great. Thank you. Dr. Andrea.
Thanks. So a couple points I want to make here. First of all, always be honest on your resume. I mean, that seems obvious, but it needs to be said. And if you can tailor your resume specifically to the job or the internship or the scholarship or whatever it is that you're applying for, and what I mean is emphasize those things that are most relevant to what you're applying for. So still be honest, right? But put the emphasis and the most explanation and the most detail that you can to show what you're doing in those areas that are of interest to that particular employer or that particular scholarship giver, right? That's gonna be super important. And the other thing I will say on the gender front is that there have been studies done saying that women tend to undersell themselves and men tend to oversell themselves. So when men see a job post, and this is statistics, right? When men see a job post that they may be marginally qualified for, they'll just go ahead and send their resume in without giving it a second thought or thinking about it. But women, on the other hand, will hesitate and say, I don't know if I'm really qualified for this. I think maybe I'm not. And then they don't apply. They don't take that shot. And from having been on hiring committees, I can say anecdotally, that sure as heck seems to be true. So sell yourself, regardless of your gender, step outside your comfort zone. If you're not sure you're quite qualified, apply anyway. What's the worst thing that happens? They delete your resume, and the worst thing that happened is you submitted it.
Great, great advice. Dr. Sarah.
But say if you have a career office or a career officer that can help look over, absolutely typos, it's not acceptable, especially when you have spell check. So use the tools at your disposal, and also a second pair of eyes is very, very important. You know, especially that the higher you get, you know, if you go to law school and you graduate and you're looking for a job, a lot of legal offices will look and see if there's any typos or the formatting is inconsistent, just something small like that. Even if you're highly qualified, they will throw out your resume. So the higher you go, it does get very, very nitpicky. So make it the best that you can. The other thing I wanted to back on, it was what Dr. Andrea said about be honest with what you say. I have, you know, I do advise students in my current position as a professor, and I have to say, be specific with what you did in your different organizations, but don't elaborate to the point where you are misrepresenting yourself. I had one student who worked on a student project, and he worked on the policy side, and he put on his CV that he was a legal advisor for the organization. you know, that those, the things like that are going to be very obvious to the person reading your CV. So you want to make sure that you have honesty and integrity. And the more specific, you know, I worked on policy for, you know, launching a high altitude balloon, or for high altitude balloon launches, or whatever it is that you're working on. If you're specific enough with it, we can see what you're looking at, and the reader that's looking at your application or your CV will see that. So, I mean, there's a fine line about, you've got to sell yourself, you know, think about all the things that you've done that maybe you forget about. You do want to put that on there, but also find a way that you to ensure that you are portraying it with honesty and integrity. And that will actually speak volumes for your character as well.
Yeah, for sure. Angie, sorry.
So just a few final points to build on the good points that have already been made. Definitely check the format, check the spelling. But on the format thing, don't get too carried away with a lot of extra graphics or strange fonts or anything. I'm reviewing resumes right now for a senior position, and I got a resume from a person, and it looks like a cartoon. I mean, there's so much color and things going on and different ways of bullet pointing that it's hard to focus on what's in the resume. So don't get too fancy like that. And again, be honest, don't pad your resume. That's a bad thing to do. And when you talk about what you've done, use action words like I did, I built, I wrote, things like that. Don't say supported, because that could mean anything. If you participated in a panel, I participated in a panel and discussed, a couple of words, but be sure that you put the action words in there, because it's important to know that you were part of a team, because teamwork is huge, all right? Teamwork is very important. And that's important as well. Let me see if I had any other points that I caught. Yeah, and keep it clean, keep the formatting clean, good words, and look forward to getting some of your resumes one day.
Thank you so much, Dr. Angie. And Will just had one more thing that he wanted to share with us real quick before we end.
Yeah, just a great shout out to some really spectacular work done by some of the young women and young people in the Brooke Owens Fellowship community. On that website, they've posted a bunch of how-to guides about things like how to request a letter of recommendation, how to prepare for a job interview, how to prepare a written essay if a work sample is required. Highly recommend them. They're very thoughtful, very well written, and have stuff that will really click and help everyone. So you can find all of those at brookowensfellowship.org.
Perfect. Thank you so much. I just want to end by saying thank you so, so much for taking the time to be with us today, to all of our panelists. I really wish that we had extra time so we could continue going, because this has been awesome to learn about so many different things in such a short amount of time. Thank you to everyone watching in the audience. Please, if you would like to go ahead and go to the next panel, there will be links to that placed in the chat by one of our moderators. We also will be posting a link to a survey that you can fill out just to give us feedback and let us know how we did with this event and any suggestions you have for future events. Thank you, everyone, and have a great, great night.
Thank you guys so much.
Thanks for having us.